Okay, in the last lecture, we have been discussing about polynomial representation of array, polynomial representation using arrays. Just to recap of that, we know that a polynomial is a collection of terms. We have defined that as a structure. Each term has an exponent and a coefficient. For the sake of simplicity, we have defined it as both as integers. Integer exponent and integer coefficient. Then we have defined a polynomial as a collection of such terms. This is a term. This is the definition of a term. Now this is an array of terms. Along with that, we have defined the total number of positive elements, total number of elements in the total number of terms in that polynomial, that is n. So the polynomial will be defined as the total number of terms plus all the terms, or this is a pointer to, more clearly, this is a pointer to an array of terms. This is the function for creating a polynomial. First we'll take the number of terms, total positive terms, then it is read into a value n. Then we'll allocate that much amount of memory. This is for typecasting that allocated memory. Usually malloc will be returning what type of pointer? Malloc will be returning void pointer. We need to typecast it to struct term star, because this is of type struct term star. So, and the total size of the memory that need to be reserved for this number of elements into size of struct term. Struct term has these two elements, integer and another integer. For example, if one integer, if it is taking 2 bytes
sir,
of memory.
Presentation order.
Oh,
sir,
sorry. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Come on.
So I was discussing about this structure, struct term, integer component, two integer component, one integer exponent, and the other one is integer coefficient. Then this is what the array of terms. Then this is how we create. There is some issue with my system. This is how we create a polynomial. We read the number of elements, then we allocate memory. This is the command for allocating memory, malloc. This command usually, this function usually returns void pointer. You need to typecast it to struct term. Then you are allocating this much amount of memory. Then you read all the elements. Once you read all the elements, you will be assigning that to specific terms. So it is for each value of I, you will be assigning a coefficient and exponent. For example, if you say that you are having some 5 elements in your polynomial, 5 terms in your polynomial, the first term it's coefficient, first term it's exponent, then second term it's coefficient, second term it's exponent, etc. So once you run this, you will get a polynomial. So this is how you create a polynomial. This is for just displaying the polynomial, how it will look like. That's it. So here what we'll be printing is for each term its coefficient and exponent. So it will be just for displaying it. Another function what I have written is for adding two polynomials. So this is going to return a pointer to a polynomial. It has got input poly 1, poly p1, and poly p2, two polynomials. So you, in this case, you are giving input as two polynomials, and what you are expecting is the sum of these two polynomials. The maximum number of terms that can be there in your resultant polynomial is p1n plus p2n. So p1 is the first polynomial and p2 is the second polynomial. So that is the maximum number of elements possible. We'll allocate that much amount of memory. Some terms is equal to the number of sorry some in some polynomial the terms array that is equal to this much memory, then if p1 terms I dot exponent is greater than p2 terms j dot exponent, if the first polynomial's first term is having higher exponent, that will be directly taken to sum. Otherwise, the opposite. If the second polynomial's first term is having higher exponent, that will be directly taken. Else means that these two terms having same exponent, then you will sum both the coefficients. So some p1 terms coefficient plus p2 terms coefficient will be added, and that's how the addition of two polynomials will be done. If the first polynomial's exponent is greater, that will be taken to sum. If the second polynomial's exponent is greater, that will be taken. Then this will be continued for each term. That is, we use three indices, I for the first polynomial, j for the second polynomial, and k for the sum polynomial. Then last we assign sum dot n is equal to number of elements in k and return that polynomial, return that sum polynomial, that's it. So this is how you can access these functions, create p1, create p2. So you will create two polynomials, p3 equal to, p3 is a pointer to polynomial, you notice that. So p3 equal to add address of p1 and address of p2, you display p3, that's it. So that's about polynomial addition. So this program is included in your lab experiment. So in today's lab session, you complete this program and I'll be creating a link on our Google Classroom. You upload your program and what output you are getting. So once if you are done with addition of polynomial, you can always do subtraction, multiplication, etc. So in your lab experiment, you will have to implement polynomial addition, subtraction, and multiplication. So these functions should be there, like create function should be there, display function, add function. Then you should have another function for subtracting, another function for multiplication. Then you properly call these functions and show the output. The program need to be uploaded and the screenshot of the output also need to be uploaded. Okay, any questions? Questions? Okay, so our next topic is sparse matrix. So what do you mean by a matrix, first of all? Matrix is having rows and columns, isn't it? Right. So a matrix can be seen as a set of rows and set of columns. So usually in different programming scenarios, you will encounter data, you will come across data in the form of matrices. Let's say you are talking about a data which is collected from, which is a survey from so many users. Let's say this is your first user, second user, third, fourth, etc. Different users, and you have you're conducting. Are you able to see my presentation right now?
Yes, sir.
So this is user 1, user 2, user 3, 4, etc. Now this is your first question in the survey, second question in the survey, third question in the survey, etc. So first question, sorry, first user, first question's answer is 0, second question's answer is 0, and so on. This question's answer is 3. So this sort of data, you, if for example, if you are trying to process, it will be usually stored in the in a matrix. So a sparse matrix is something where you have maximum number of the number of non-zero elements in your matrix is very small. The number of non-zero elements in this matrix. So this is a very this is a sparse matrix with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 only 8 non-zero entries. So this usually happens in the case of survey data and all. For example, if the survey question was number of number of cars in your house, number of bikes in your house, etc. Then say, and this survey was taken in a very rural area, then this value will be zero for this person, this value will be zero for this person, and so many, and so like that, so many zeros will be there. So number of non-zero values will be very very less. That sort of a matrix is called sparse matrix. Now let's see a sparse matrix. What is the difficulty in dealing with a sparse matrix? If the matrix is very large, then we say that if the matrix is very large and for example, this has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 8. This is an 8 into 9 matrix. 8 into 9 matrix. Let's say this matrix is having matrices taking integer values. Then, and each of the integer is taking 2 bytes of data. Then this is 8 into 9 into 2. That many number of bytes. That many number of bytes it is going to take. What about if you are able to come with a representation of this matrix, because there are so many zeros that can be avoided? What about if you are able to represent this matrix with a compressed or a representation which is taking some number of bytes which is much less than this? So we are going to discuss about such a representation, a sparse matrix representation using arrays. There are two different representations. One is a three column coordinate list representation, and another method is a compressed sparse row representation. We'll be discussing this representation in detail. Those are interested, you can look at this representation also. What I was trying to tell is a sparse matrix is a same as a general matrix, but we have very less number of non-zero entries. So in that case, we will try to come up with a compressed representation of this matrix with some other technique. This is one technique for representing that. This we'll see these two techniques in detail. So this is your three column coordinate list representation. You have a 8 into 9 sparse matrix here. Now instead of this matrix, what I am going to store is this three column representation. That's it. So this matrix has got one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and eight number of elements, eight number of non-zero elements that is stored in the very first row. This will be having 8 plus 1 row, total 9 rows. So this matrix, the three column representation is once again in the form of a matrix or a two-dimensional array. It will be having three columns. First column represents row, second column represents column, and the third column represents the actual element. So the first column is the row number 1, the next column is the column number 8, and the third column is the actual element 3. So 1, 8, 3. This is the second element, is second row, third column 1, 2, 3, the third column, and the actual element is 8. So like that, you represent all the elements. That's it. That is what the three column representation is. You represent each element as its row number, column number, and the corresponding element. And in the very first entry will be the number of columns, sorry, number of rows in the matrix, number of columns in the matrix, and number of non-zero entries in the matrix. That's it. That is what is a three-column representation or a coordinate list representation of a sparse matrix. So as I have told, we have an 8x9 sparse matrix with 8 elements, 8 non-zero entries. So 8x9 is represented here, 8, 9. So this is 8x9 matrix, and this 8 represents the number of non-zero entries. And each of these non-zero entries, you have an entry corresponding to the each of these non-zero elements, you have an entry corresponding to that. The first entry is first row, 8th column. Second entry is second row, 3rd column. Third entry is second row, 6th column. That's it. This is the compressed sparse row representation. Once again, this is our 8x9 sparse matrix. 8x9, 8 rows and 9 columns sparse matrix. You can represent this as another in another way, that is called the compressed sparse row. Instead of this matrix, we represent this as three one-dimensional arrays. The first array is all the non-zero elements in this list, in this array. This is 3, 8, 10, 4, 2, 6, 9, and 5. All the non-zero elements will be stored as an array A. Please note that you need to store in the same order as the element arrays. That is, first row, then you scan through all columns. Second row, scan through all columns. Third row, you scan through. In the third row, you see that there is no non-zero element. Fourth row, all the elements. So in the same order as it arises in the matrix, in the sparse matrix. And IA represents the row and JA represents the column. IA, the first entry is always 0, and the second entry is number of elements in the first row, 1. The third entry is number of elements in the second row plus the number of elements in the first row, that is total up to the second row. 3. Total up to fourth row is once again 3, because there is no non-zero entries. Total up to fourth row is 4. So always you can get the number of elements in the first row as 1 minus 0, you will get 1. Number of elements in the second row, 3 minus 1, 2. Number of elements in the fourth row, 3 minus 3, 0, like that. So IA represents the number of elements in that particular row. The first entry is 0, and the second entry onwards, number of elements in that corresponding row plus the all the previous rows. Then JA represents all the column numbers. So for example, the first element 3 corresponds to a column 8. The second element 8 corresponds to a column 3. Third element corresponds to column 6, and so on. So these two are directly related. This represents the row, but this row number of elements in the row should be calculated like this: 1 minus 0, 3 minus 1, 3 minus 3, 4 minus 3, and so on. Now you can see that the number of bytes this representation that is going to take is 8x9x2. 8x9x2 is 144 bytes. And in this representation, the number of bytes or number total space taken will be number of bytes will be equal to this plus this plus this, 8 plus 9 plus 8, and this multiplied by, if each integer is going to take 2 bytes, a total of 50 bytes. So you can see that you can very well see that here then general representation of a matrix is it was taking 144 bytes, but your compressed representation is taking 50 bytes only. Any questions so far? So these are the two sparse matrix representation using arrays. Both are going to this first representation is going to use a two-dimensional array itself. Three-column representation we call an array with three columns. A compressed sparse row representation is going to use three separate arrays: one for representing the elements itself, second for representing its row numbers, third for representing its column numbers. Let's see an example. Let's say you have two sparse matrices. So this is how you create a sparse matrix in a computer with which uses less amount of memory. And now let's see how we can add two sparse matrices using our compressed representation. Addition of two sparse matrices. So this is a general matrix representation. This is one sparse matrix. It has got 5 into 6 elements. This also has 5 into 6 elements. So you can add these two elements, A plus B. You get this. This row is having 0006. In this case, there is no value, so it is same. Here you have 7. And in the same place you have 3, so these two elements will be added, 0 0, then 5, and so on. This is just matrix addition. See, the same matrix I have represented the same matrix using our three column representation. This is 0th row, 0th column, sorry, 0th row, 1st row, 2nd row, 3rd row, 4th row, and 5th row. In the 1st row, we have been representing total number of rows, total number of columns, and total number of non-zero entries. So in this case, it is 5 rows, 6 columns, and 5 number of non-zero entries. So these are the 5 non-zero entries. In the first row, fourth column, you have one entry, 6. Second row, second column, you have 7. Third row, second column, you have this. Third row, fourth column, you have this, and so on. B is having 5 rows, 6 columns, and 6 non-zero entries. This is our sparse matrix B. And its corresponding sparse matrix representation using three column representation. This is the sum of these two sparse matrices. You can see that the number of rows and number of columns should be equal, then only we can add two matrices, right? So number of rows is 5, number of columns is 6. Then number of elements, we don't know the number of elements in the beginning. Here it is actually 9. You use a variable, an index I for this. You use another variable, another index j for this, and another index k for this array. Let's say all the entries are blank here. Then I is equal to 0. Sorry, I is equal to 1. The 0th entry is always the number of rows, number of columns, and number of non-zero elements. So we'll start from I is equal to 1, j is equal to 1, and k is equal to 1. I value is 1. J value is 2. J of 1 is 2. So J is pointing here. I is pointing here. So I's row is 1. J's row is 2. So which element should we come first? Which is having the smallest value for the row? Because this element is in the first row. See, here in the first row there is no elements. Here in the first row we have one element, so that first row need to be copied to the sum. That is what we are going to do here. So in the first row you have one element. Here in the first row there is no element, so you copy this content to sum. 1, 4, 6, that is copied here. you increment k, k plus plus, increment I, I plus plus. So I will be here now, and k will be here. Now I is pointing to a row number 2. J is also pointing to a row number 2. The rows are equal. Now you look at column. I is pointing to a row number, column number 2. J is also pointing to a column number 2. Means that its row number and column number both are equal. So in this case, you are here. Row number and column number both are equal. So you have to add this element 7 with this element 3. So here I is pointing to row number 2, column number 2. J is also pointing to row number 2, column number 2. So you add the element 7 with 3 and put it here. So 2, 2 and 10. Now increment K. Then increment I and increment J. J plus plus. All are incremented because you have used I's value, J's value, and K always will be utilized. Now we can see that J is having row number 2, I is having column row number 3, which is having smaller column, row number. J is having this smaller value, so this element will be copied, 255. Then J will be incremented. Yeah, I is having 3, J is also having 3. Continue like that. Then if the idea is this, whichever is having smaller row number, that will be copied. Whichever is having if the row numbers are equal, then you look at column number also. If row numbers are equal but column numbers are different, then the smallest column number value will be copied. If row number and column number both are equal, then you will have to take the sum of both the elements. I think there is a mistake in this part. Now we'll try to write a program for this, representing array using array representation of sparse matrix. So,
sir,
excuse me.
Sir, can I ask a doubt?
Sir,
in the last one, that the third column in A and third index position in A and third index position in B, 3, 2. So 2 plus 2 equal to 4 should be the answer, no? In fourth one, in the key. The last.
This value, right?
2 plus 2 here, the it should be 4, no? Sir, I didn't understand.
Is this 3? The value we are talking about. There is a small mistake in the slide. I'll tell you. Three, two, two, and this is 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 2. This value is. This 2 is corresponding to third row, second column, and this 2 is third row, third column. By mistake, it was 2 here. That may be your the difficulty, isn't it? So this should come first, 3, 2, 2. It is here. Then 3, 3, 2. This is here. Then this will come, 3, 4, 5. Right?
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we'll try to implement this as a C program. In order to implement this, we'll create this as an array of structures, as we have done in the case of polynomial. So this, we are going to create this as a structure, an integer I, which is representing a row, an integer J, which is representing a column, an integer X, which is representing the corresponding element. So this is the row number, column number, and the element itself. So this is the structure for representing an element. Now the entire sparse matrix is represented as an array of structures, an array of these elements. So there will be some number of elements which will allocate memory in runtime, and we need these three values. How many rows are there in your matrix? How many columns are there in your matrix? And how many non-zero entries? So M represents number of rows in the matrix, N represents number of columns, and num represents the number of non-zero entries in your sparse matrix, right? So you have two structures here. One is for representing a single element in your sparse matrix, and this structure is going to represent this entire part. This structure represents this small part, and this structure represents the entire part. Let's see the code for creating a sparse matrix, a function. Into this, we'll read the matrix dimension, the dimension of the matrix, 5 rows and 6 columns, and you will insert that here, 5 and 6, s pointer n and s pointer m and s pointer n. As I've told, m is the number of rows and n is the number of columns. So you directly insert it here, s is equal to s pointer m and s pointer n. Then enter number of non-zero entries, that also will be read into this place. So number of rows, m, n, and s pointer num. Now, corresponding to this number of elements, you need to allocate memory in runtime, and s pointer e equal to malloc s pointer num into size of element. So this size of element is for a single element into, in this case, 5. So for example, this was taking 1, 2, 3 integers, so it will be taking 6 bytes into 5 number of. So there are 6 entries, 5 entries here. For each entry, we need to store, and this is stored separately. Even if we have represented this, shown this in a single block, this was represented separately and this was represented separately in our implementation. More clearly, we can say that this data is stored in your stack part of the memory, and this data is stored in the heap part of your memory, because this memory was allocated in runtime and the other was allocated. We have been directly creating it, isn't it? Yes. Right. So now, once if you are allocated memory, then you can read that many number of elements, that is row number, column number, actual entry itself, I, J, and X. EI, 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 EI dot I, EI dot J, EI dot X. I, J, and X. I is row number, J is the column number. First row, fourth column. First row, fourth column. 1, 4, and the actual entry is 6. Second row, second column, the actual entry is 7. So once you do that, your sparse matrix is available in your memory like this. Not like this, it is like this. So it will be utilizing only less amount of memory compared to the actual matrix representation. If you're compared to your memory usage of the general matrix representation. Any questions so far? Now we'll look at a program for adding sparse matrices. This we have already discussed without a program code. Here just I have added a program code, that's it. We have matrix A, matrix B, the same matrix I have taken we had this matrix, matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C. A is corresponding 3 column representation, B is corresponding 3 column representation, A is having 5 rows, 6 columns, and 5 non-zero elements, 5 rows, 6 columns, and 6 non-zero elements. For 5, 6 non-zero elements, you have 5 entries. For this 6 non-zero entries, you have 6 non-zero elements. Now, how you are going to do addition? You place an index here, place an index here, place an index here. And these two entries are same. This entry will be calculated at the end. So index I is here, I, and index j will be here, as I've told. Index k will be here. You initialize I is equal to 1, j is equal to 1, and k is equal to 1 or 0, whatever. It should point to the beginning, that's it. If you are using the implementation where this part is stored separately and this part is stored separately, then I should be 0 and j should be 0, k should be 0. Now you read the value at this position, that is S1. This we represent this as S1 and this as S2. S1 pointer EI, this is your E. EI means I is equal to 0. EI means E0, first entry. Dot I. Dot I means this row. Dot J means your column. Like that, S2 EJ means this row. So S1 EI dot I is first entry here. S2 EJ dot I is first entry here. You compare these two. This is how we have done, isn't it? So the first, we compare the rows. If whichever row is smaller, that will be copied. So 1, 4, 6 need to be copied here. So that is the statement written here. If S1 EI dot I is less than S2 EJ dot I, then you copy that to sum. Sum is your new pass matrix or C. C is equal to here sum. So sum dot E K plus plus equal to sum S1 dot. So into sum, you copy S1. Then increment K and increment I. J will be kept as it is. Now we compare, you will be running this while loop until this condition. So you will be incrementing j. Now I is equal to 2 and j is also 2. Then you will come into, you will come out of this, and this is also not 2. You will come here, then you will check whether this condition is true. That is, you go to, so this part, it is going to compare the row, and this part, it compares the column. Once, if the row numbers are same, for example, this case, 3 and 2, 2 and 2, this 2 and this 2. So these row numbers are same, then you go for the column numbers. If the column numbers are also same, then you will go this part. So in this case, you are going to actually add the two elements. For example, this condition is going to come. That is, row number is 2, row number is 2, column number is 2, column number is also 2. So it will be 7 plus 3. So this addition will be done here. S1 EII plus plus dot X plus, this is your actual element addition. Now, if the row numbers are same and the column numbers are different, for example, in this case, it was 3, isn't it? 3, 2, 2 and 3, 3, 2. So, row numbers are same, 3 and 3. Column numbers are different, 3, 2 and 3. So, the whichever column number that is having value less, that will be copied. 3, 2, 2 will be copied first, 3, 2, 2. So, that will be done here. S1, E, I, dot j refers to column. S2 ej j means refers to the second matrices column. Row numbers are same, that's why we came here. Then you copy. If this is having smaller column, then you copy by using this statement. So that's it. Any questions? Okay, I'll be sharing this program, this as a program in your Google Classroom. I have a program. you're able to see this program, right? So the same thing, same program which we have, I have explained. Excuse me. Sorry. Yeah. So this is the structure of an element, and this is the sparse matrix. This is how you create this. Already we have explained. You have to allocate that much amount of memory, number of elements into size of element. Then you read each element in such a way that row into row number, column number, and the element itself. Once you do it, your program, sparse matrix will be created. This is just for displaying the sparse matrix in the form of a matrix itself. Display function. You try to understand it, and this is how you add these two sparse matrix. You initialize I, j, and k values as zero, then create a sum sparse matrix which is having a maximum of this much amount of elements. This much amount of memory need to be allocated. Then if the row numbers, comparison of row numbers are done by using this set of this part of the code, comparison of column numbers are done with the help of this part of the code. If both the row numbers and column numbers are equal, then the element, the actual element will be sum, that is s1 element dot x plus s2 element dot x. And this loop will be continued till any one of the list is getting exhausted. This is what the condition. Once any one of the list is exhausted, you need to copy the entire, the rest of the other list, balance of the other list. That is done with the help of these two statements. Then later on, you add the total number of elements to your part, that is wherever you have reached this value k. So that's it for the time being. Any questions? Any questions? Okay, thank you.